Merci. I'd like to congratulate the AAB for having and maintaining and keeping alive the flame. It's not easy at times to be the standard bearer for communications in the Atlantic provinces, which make up 4 of the 10 provinces of Canada. Remembering that Newfoundland is 3 times as big as Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, and Prince Edward Island. And Newfoundland is bigger than 12 American states combined. It's bigger than every state in the United States except Alaska, Texas, and it's just about the same size as California, which has 29 million population. And we have, as of today, 20,000 less than we had 2 years ago. I congratulate Hillary for taking on the presidency for this year. I congratulate Mr. Soper for his team having 3 over par today and winning the golf tournament. And I certainly congratulate the gentleman from Midwest Broadcasting Group who had such a brilliant presentation this morning. All of the presentations and all of the cross-fertilization of information is where the game is. If we come together in unity after a week of funerals, where the only thing that brought us together, 2.5 billion people, was a funeral of a lady who arrived here in 1983, a young mother with a year-and-a-half-old child, who we have many hours of films, and that was the funeral of an individual. It's funny when you think of life, that it's always the individual who we remember. Anybody who's visited Napoleon's tomb in France, in Paris, or the various monuments around the world to Caesars and to Cleopatra, who there were 7 Cleopatras. The last one, when she decided to commit suicide, had a man brought in front of her and her court every day for 6 months. And had a different kind of snake bite him. And see how badly he died and what agony. And finally found a viper where it was painless. And that's what she decided to commit suicide when she took it to her breast. I just throw this in, having come from a woman's meeting where I was asked not to call them ladies. Call them. I said, my mother and my wife and my grandmother, everybody's a lady. That's the way I look at the feminine group. We wouldn't be here without them. And they said, we're women. We're not ladies. Well, it's a funny movie. When you're suddenly told by the women that they're not ladies. Anyway. We're here tonight gathering together and celebrating the consciousness of our creative ability. All of you who represent Nova Scotia and Prince Edward Island and New Brunswick and Newfoundland and Labrador and the Americans, United States citizens among us, I acknowledge, are in an incredible industry. When you consider that we're communicating now right around the planet, tonight's film, which will be on around 1 o'clock of this event, will be seen in the Caribbean. It will be seen in Bermuda. In fact, it's top rated in Bermuda. We've been in Bermuda for 18 months. It'll be seen in Mexico. And if you've got a dish, it'll be seen in anywhere in North America. Perfect picture in Arizona. Perfect sound from Oz in Arizona. We're on the threshold of an incredible, unbelievable, unimaginative, hard to conceive revolution in our field. It's hard to conceive the inconceivable. It's very difficult to conceive the inconceivable. But in the last few years, and certainly in the last few weeks, we've had a revolution here in the sense that 74% decided that we want a different educational system. Well, the key to the future is the education of our children. There is nothing else as important, and therefore every child should have a PC availability and access in your schools, without exception. Unless we connect all our schools into the internet so they have the advantage and maximization of input and downloading on all levels, we're not doing the right thing by our children. And when you see the unbelievable, staggering national debt, which is in Canada is approaching $1 trillion, $1,000 billion. In the United States, it's approaching $10 trillion, $10,000 billion. While I am speaking, the national debt is running up into the millions, and we have to face this eventually. Joey Smallwood, when I talked to him in Cuba, and when we were in Morocco and India, I said to him, Joe, I have an update of the national debt of this moment. Well, the national debt, for your interest, in Canada is $599,633,729 as of 2 hours ago. And that's only 60% of the debt, so it's almost $1 trillion, because they don't count there the debts of the provinces. So you got a $1 trillion debt. I asked the finance minister of Newfoundland the other night out in Torbay what the Newfoundland debt was, seeing Joey started with a $30 million surplus. He said, well, as of today, it's about $9 billion, $300 million. Now there's 545,000 of us, and we got 272,000 homes. And every one of us, every man, woman, and child in this room right now, you want to find out how much you owe? Not only every man, woman, and child in this room, but everybody you've left at home, whether they're 1 year old, 6 weeks old, 25 years old, or 150, you owe owe $19,589.85. Every one of you. Now, in order to pay $19,000, you've got to make double that. So you've got to make $40,000 in order to pay the $20,000, right? As Frank knows only too well, seeing we're in a 54% bracket. Not only are we in a 54% bracket, but if we want to hire somebody, we got to pay a tax, a payroll tax. Just imagine. If I want to hire 400 people, I got to pay about whatever it is, payroll tax. If I want, as an unemployed man, to get a job, and I want to put an ad on radio or television or newspapers in Newfoundland, I got to pay a tax. There's an advertising tax in Newfoundland, if you can believe it. There's only one other place where they got an advertising tax, and that's Quebec. Just imagine, to get an ad, to get a job, you got to have a tax. We have reached the stage. Well, I don't think the political figures know it, but we are on the threshold of a revolution. We had three huge boats, cut loose in the harbor a few nights ago. One of them had no crew on board and floated across the harbor, which could have been a disaster. It's just the tip of the iceberg of what's going on that's politically incorrect to discuss. There seems to be an incredible amount of things that are politically incorrect to discuss. You take a word and you twist it and you change it and you manipulate it, and you take a substance matter that may be 1/6 of 1 ounce that sells in Acapulco for $1, and you claim that someone had a grain, there's 480 grains in an ounce, and they get 7 years in jail, buddy. It's not a laughing matter anymore. When we look at the outrageous abuse of our children, having taken law at college, I'm well aware that the law friends I had all indulged in various substances, to put it mildly. Most of those guys are now judges. Oh, what a tangled web we weave when we start to deceive ourselves about what is righteous, what is integral, what is the integrity. We just heard Mayor John explain how he wrote the letters for the newspaper to get it started, to fuel the pump of input, cross-reference, cross-fertilization of ideas. Well, we have this huge debt in Newfoundland to face, and each one of you from different provinces has an equal debt. We've been told by the politicians who've been desperately selling off Canadian gold in the last year, just as Australia has been selling off Canadian gold, and even the Swiss are now selling off Canadian gold in order to pay to the Eugenians victims the money they stole from them during the Holocaust. And they're melting down $7 billion in gold. You wonder why the gold prices are holding at 321. If you take the gold and project it with the MIT, the Massachusetts Institute, based on the paper in circulation, now approaching $10 trillion, it means that 10% within 4 years, that's more than the total taxes collected in the United States. The United States Army, Navy, and Air Force absorb $300 billion, a billion a day, to keep you protected from who knows who. We're not quite sure. Because once you lose an enemy like Russia, you've got to find another enemy. Well, who will we take on today? Let's see now. What about Newfoundland? What about Canada? Canada's got the water. We need the grandfather water. The Canadians are passive. The headlines in Maclean's magazine today says they're passive, dull. Well, they're underestimating Canada. Canada is the second greatest landmass in the world. And the Canadian is an incredibly honest, straightforward person. It's a lot better to be dull than shiny and double talk. The Canadian from coast to coast that I've met, and this is particularly true, I think, of all of us, we know this. I know that in Quebec, which I had never ever really learnt the language very brilliantly, to put it mildly, but at least I was able to speak 300 or 400 words in those days. And it's true, all of us who are bilingual here, or any who are bilingual, know how difficult it is if you're not maintaining the language. You forget it. When you live in Spain, you start to pick up Spanish. When you live in Mexico, and then you start to forget it. I'd love to be able to be bilingual like the taxi drivers in New York. Who can speak about 50 languages, but can't find the road you're going to. Those of us who are trying desperately to communicate, and thank God for the 570 lines, because there was no way in the world that I could communicate to our people throughout the areas we're operating without a 570 line that you press a button and it's a conference call and you tell everybody, because being in the loop is vital. It's vital for everybody to be informed, and we haven't managed this well this yet. Because as we looked ahead 25 years and planned the 25 years, we realized we had to take down. First of all, we had to get rid of our mainland stations. We had to get rid of the AM stations. We had to cut away from a technology that was dead. The fact that you can put an AM station off the air in Corner Brook and not even bother to put it on indicates where you're going with monaural radio. Fine if you're going to do a 100% talk show and you're going to have the lack of honesty, lack of a conscience, to put a guy like Howard Stern on the air and let him call the French Canadian. I don't want to even repeat what he called them. I mean, the minor thing was to call them Nazis and wimps and idiots. I mean, for 20 minutes, this guy's loose out of New York. Not only out of New York, he's over 40 major cities, including Los Angeles. He's in Toronto on a different station, not owned by Chum, I gather, but in Montreal, he's on the station I started as a spiritual station, Shom, Om, the last word in the universe, the vibrations of a whole new reality. Every one of my staff at Shom went to India, and many of them are still there, living there in the Himalayas in Kulu, K-U-L-L-U. where you can rent a house for $20 a month. In Montreal, we show them, when I reached 1,200,000 BBM, that's when the freakout started with the French, because they knew that there's only 500,000 English in Quebec. And therefore, if I had 1,000,002, I had 700,000 of their audience. Then they told me I couldn't say, comment ça va. That's when I decided to sell it. Because if we're going to have Canadian unity, and an English station in Quebec, the only one for 7 years, can't have its announcers who are French language people say, comment ça va, comment allez-vous, monsieur. You've got to have a real evaluation of what the meaning of unity is. And it doesn't have any meaning if I couldn't talk to the hundreds of thousands of American tourists coming in to Quebec and not even say, welcome to Quebec, comment ça va, and so on. When I was told that, I decided to sell all the stations. I decided that the game was up as far as I was concerned. I was going to go back to Newfoundland, get on the satellite, cover the planet, and forget it. You stop Howard by not being greedy and willing to compromise your integrity regardless of what he does or says, because you're so hidden in the background that no one knows who owns the shares in the company anyway. That's how you stop anything. That's why our corporation is so efficient and effective, as you'll see later on, when I'm going to show you something we finished in commemory of Diane. Because it's been a tragic week. Madame Teresa's left the movie. Diane, who allowed herself to become disillusioned, who was trapped into a marriage to breed two kings. And the disillusionment of that was self-evident when she was here in 1983. Nobody can live in the same room with a woman or a man when they're having an external vibrational affair with somebody else over the years. That's why Elvis Presley died. Patricia was pulling that game on him for 3 years with his karate man in the room. I know the women don't agree on this. I know I've had many arguments on this one. But when you're in a room or a house where there's betrayal, a subtle betrayal, I mean, I don't think we should tell children about Santa Claus and give them the illusion that Santa Claus exists except as a spiritual giver from their parents. Because the child, I remember as a little child trying to defend Santa Claus against 7 and 8 year old kids at school, at kindergarten. And it was difficult because suddenly you realize it's not true. He doesn't come down and you leave rum out for him. And he doesn't exist. So you feel the first betrayal. Once you're betrayed, your whole guard is up, right? Once you betray, you never trust anybody again at that level. It's very difficult, trust. Trust their decision. Trust their intelligence. Trust their discretion. Trust their comprehension. Trust their idiosyncrasies not being so difficult that you can't understand them. You've got to have trust. It's not much fun. This is why it's so much fun to get back to Newfoundland, folks. And I'm sure those of you from different parts of the world, regardless of where it is, feel the same way when you get home. And you bloom where you're planted. As Newfoundlanders, any of us who come back, have no illusions. How long we're away, we want to get back. It's true everywhere. I cannot believe the email I get saying, Geoff, thanks for the NTV news and Oz. Here I am out in Edmonton trying to make it, but at night I'm enjoying being part of Newfoundland again, and I feel the contact. And now being on the Oz web around the world, I mean, when you can have a computer and pick up Oz in Tokyo like they're doing and having letters from Tokyo, it's a thrilling time to be alive. It's a thrilling time to be in this business and to see all the people, some of them I haven't seen for years. George Ferguson, who came down to CKWW. I mean, I could go on all night. There's at least 20, 30, 40 people in this room who have worked for one of our organizations and have made a tremendous contribution. It's always a teamwork. There's no individual who does it. The only reason I took the high jump on was I didn't have to depend on anybody else. That if you're playing a game of basketball, if some guy doesn't want to get in condition. It's like Brian Vallis and some of the other men in this room who do 60 and 70 miles a week to get that physical body in shape. Without a physical body, you don't have a mind. A single pound of excess flesh is 4 miles of capillaries, arteries, and veins. If you're 10 pounds overweight, you got 40 miles. The blood got to go to the brain from here to Harvard, from here to Hollywood. 10 pounds, 40 miles. 20 pounds, 80 miles. 100 pounds, 400 miles. This is the thing that I kept, the litany I kept to myself was, look, Geoff, you're the same weight as you were when you were high jumping. The only difference is most people later on in life get into eating, and I love to eat. I mean, if I'm hungry, I eat. If I'm not hungry, I don't eat. If my wife looks after the orange juice, and other friends have sent me orange juice, and I get off an orange juice. In fact, in one case in India, I lived for 85 days on orange juice and honey because it was such a funny place, and I wasn't about to eat some of the stuff they were eating. But as for the mileage, I've been told, and the time is up. I mean, I've been told I got 20 minutes. I'm good for 20 hours. But what I'd like to do, because I know you've got most of you got something to do, and our organization will hear me for much longer, I can assure you, on our meetings, because I congratulate them all. We've had the best year in the history of our corporation. And that doesn't happen by accident. That happens by having a 25-year plan, a 20-year plan, a 15-year plan, a 10-year plan, a 5-year plan, a 3-year plan, a 1-year plan, a 6-month plan, and every 6 months you reevaluate the plan. Now you never have any problems. You know where you're going. That's what we do. That's why when we knew we had to close down all our stations on the Kenmount Road, we had to move all the towers. We thank the Roman Catholic Church for letting us have a little land on top of a mountain because they owned all the land on the south side. And they were very, very cooperative in giving us space to be 2,000 feet higher so we could get into Bonavista Bay. People here don't realize, I mean, many of us, even ourselves, when we don't go past the auto route or the underpass, the Great Northern Peninsula is bigger than Portugal. Newfoundland is bigger than Japan, slightly, and Japan has 136 million people. I mean, the size of Newfoundland, to drive, I know that very few politicians ever drive from St. John's to Port au Basque. If they did, we'd have a 4-lane highway from... if they did, we'd have a 4-lane highway from Whitburn to Corner Brook. And I can well identify with Prince William, which happens to be my middle name, walking behind the coffin, because I did it with my mother when I was 13, too. And I want to play tonight the composition we've done of the Diana film and let you see the creativity of John and our staff, of Paul Kinsman, that within hours... Last Saturday night, I had this together, and we had it refined through the week. And I'm going to show it to you tonight. Are you going to look it after? I'm going to show it to you tonight. I think that maybe that if we bring down the lights in the. I want to say thank you, by the way. I've enjoyed the opportunity to talk to a lot of old friends and those who I've never met before in my life. But I wish you nothing but well. I wish the convention well. I congratulate the organizers, I congratulate the visitors to Newfoundland, and I welcome all our own people, and I tell you that we're going to have a party if we ever get the rain to stop. We had to cancel last week, but we're going to have an outdoor to handle 1,000 people, but we'll probably have an indoor. It'll be a little crowded. Anyway, and now we have the film we did and have presented. And it's an original, by the way, as far as the cutaways of Newfoundland are concerned. And here's Elton John's song, which was sold out today in England in less than 3.5 hours. Thank you.
Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You are the grace that placed yourselves where lives were torn apart. You called out to our country, and you whispered to those in pain, now you belong to heaven, and the stars spell out your name. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Loveliness we've lost, those empty days without your smile, this torch we'll always carry for our nation's golden child. Even though we try, the truth brings us to tears, all our words cannot express the joy you've brought us through the years. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You were the greatest place to set where lives were torn apart. Goodbye, English rose, from a country lost without your soul. We'll miss the wings of your compassion more than you will ever know. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. Your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You are the grace that placed yourselves where lives were torn apart. You called out to our country, and you whispered to those in pain, now you belong to heaven, and the stars spell out your name. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Loveliness we've lost, those empty days without your smile, this torch we'll always carry for our nation's golden child. Even though we try, the truth brings us to tears. All our words cannot express the joy you brought us through the years. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You were the greatest place to set us where lives were torn apart. Goodbye, England's rose. From a country lost without your soul, who missed the wings of your compassion more than you will ever know. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will.